good to be here together with each other, but to be here with God in his presence, in his house on this day. So welcome you to Cornerstone. If you're watching online, wherever you are in the world, welcome to Evenwood.
Yes.
Somebody did used to say it, the best church in the world.
It is.
I'm not saying that, I'm not biased in any way, shape or form, but...
It is.
Yeah, yeah. If you say that, that's fine, I'm saying nothing. It's good to be together. A couple of notices before we get going. We have booked a Christmas meal for church on Saturday the 18th of December at 12:30. Saturday the 18th, so it's basically the Saturday before Christmas, at 12:30 at Midridge, the Bay Horse in Midridge. Menus are down here. All the information is there. It's £10 deposit, and if you could get your menus and deposits in by next Sunday, please. By next Sunday, if you can. It's 12:30, we tried to get an evening meal, and there wasn't any. I think we could have got it something like 9 o'clock, but that's a bit late. So it's 12:30 on Saturday, the 18th of December. Everybody and anybody's welcome. As long as you pay your deposit and give me your menu by next week, you can come. If you don't give me your deposit and menu by next Sunday, you're not coming. So they actually said, I called in yesterday and they said, we need menus back as soon as possible. Like I think the man was meaning sort of like today or tomorrow, but I said, is next weekend all right? Yeah, it's fine. So if you would give your menus, obviously, to me in the week, I'm not going to be here next weekend. So would you give them to Anne? Any money and any menus, please give them to Anne next Sunday morning, if that's okay. That's the main thing. And as I said, everyone's welcome. Everyone, however many people you would like to invite. I booked provisionally for 20, but they said as long as we know in plenty of time, we can have more or less. So that should be a nice time coming to Christmas. We don't want to mention the word Christmas. But it's only 5 weeks yesterday. Oh. I think, is it 5 weeks? Yeah? Yes. 4 weeks, 5 weeks? So, it's coming regardless if we're ready or not. We've also got lots and lots of prayer requests this morning. And as we're getting ready today in church and setting up, Helen Smith, she's been up most of the night, not well at all. So, we pray for Helen and Alan. Who obviously would have been here this morning, but she said they're just not well enough. She's been, as I say, poorly in the night. Keith's not well, so we pray for Keith as well. Brenda's here, which is good to see. Keith's not well. Ernie's also not so good. There's a little boy, I don't know if you know, Susan and Kenny Sadler from Beyond Limits. Well, I think it's their grandson, Noah. He's only a baby, he's really, really poorly, he's not well at all. He hasn't been responsive for the last couple of days. And I think he's just started to sort of respond to medication and things. So they really need prayer for little Noah. And Lynn's just said about James Rowley, who is, he lives in the village just down there, and he works in the shop. He's in hospital, he's really poorly as well. Does have a brain... He does have a brain tumour already, but obviously he gets on with things, but he's not good at all. I mean, I just saw him the other day as well, so. So let's come, as we come together, because it's good when we can be together, we can share together, and actually when we can pray for the community, because we are the church. It's not the building, we are the church, but actually all the people that say they belong to church, they would count Cornerstone as their church. And we are, as a community, believing together for God to move, for God to do things in these situations. So as we begin this morning, let's lift up these people to God. And Lord, I thank you that you are the God who hears and answers prayer. I thank you that you are the God who, Lord, can intervene in situations and circumstances, Lord, where doctors can only do so much. Lord, I thank you that you are the God of miracles. And that, Lord, as we come this morning, we are believing that you will do something in these places, in these situations, in these homes, in this hospital, wherever these people are. I pray that you would be there as well. I pray that your presence would be felt, and I pray that they will know your healing. We pray for Helen and Alan, Lord, up there in Manor Court. I pray that you would be everything they need, that you would be their strength, that you'd be their peace, and that, Lord, you would be their healing, their healer. And Lord, we pray for Keith as well, down at West Auckland, and we pray that, Lord, you would be his strength as well, that you would heal his body, that you would be with him. And Lord, Brenda, that you'd be bless her as well. And Lord, this little baby Noah, Lord, I thank you that you, Lord, love all people. And Lord, we think of this little baby, we think of Noah right now. And Lord, you know the circumstance, you know the need that he has. And Lord, we pray that you will meet the need. We pray that you will be with the family as they maybe are struggling and finding it difficult at this time. Lord, help them to have faith, help them to stand strong in you, and help them, Lord, to believe for a miracle for this little baby. And Lord, we pray for James. And Lord, I thank you for his openness. I thank you for the conversations that we have very often in the street. And Lord, I pray that where he is right now, I pray that, Lord, he will know your healing hand. He will know your touch upon his brain or whatever is wrong with him. Lord, I pray that you made him, you created him. And Lord, I pray that you will meet his need right now. And I pray, Lord, even through this, that, Lord, he will come to know you. That he will come to salvation. That, Lord, he will know the greatest gift of all, Lord. And that is the gift of salvation, of knowing you, of having you as the Lord of his life. So we pray for James and Sybil, Lord, and I pray that you be with them as well. Lord, Ernie as well, we think of Ernie who's not so good. And Lord, it sometimes seems like we come with a list. But Lord, these are the people who mean so much to us. These are people on our hearts. And Lord, you see each of our hearts. And Lord, those people that we haven't mentioned today, you know them. You know where they are. You know their situation. And Lord, I pray that you will move within their lives and in their situation. Lord, I think of Jesus in the Bible when he did so many miracles and he healed people. And Lord, I pray for miracles to happen in these situations. I pray, Lord, as we come next week and the week after, we will hear stories about, oh yes, I just felt like God was touching me. I felt something within me. And Lord, I pray that you will be there. You will get the glory for these things. In the name of Jesus, we ask it. And Lord, as we gather together today, Lord, we ask for your presence to be with us. We ask, Lord, for us to hear your voice. We ask that we will come with open hearts, open minds, that we won't come with a certain mindset, but Lord, that we will just open ourselves to the moving of your Spirit in this place. Come, Holy Spirit. Come and do those things that only you can do. Take over this time, Lord, we ask in the name of Jesus, that, Lord, your name will be uplifted, that your word will be spoken, that, Lord, your Spirit would move in our hearts. Come and change us. Make us more like you. We ask it. Amen. 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 And if you feel led to pray as we're worshipping at any point, then again, add your prayers to the prayers that have already gone up. I'm sure God does not get tired of hearing our prayers. God doesn't get tired of hearing us speak to him, of hearing us communicate with him, because he desires that closeness today. As we draw close to him, he will draw close to us. Amen. I'm going to come and give God the glory to begin with. You know, it's almost like speaking in faith. It's almost like saying, yes, we prayed for all of these people. Right, to God be the glory. Great things he has done. To God be the glory, the miracles that are going to happen. To God be the glory. Let's say thank you to God for what it hasn't even happened yet.
Yes,
to give him the glory is why we are here. Amen. We want to be playing with the piano because it's completely gone off.
Oh, right.
Okay.
To God be the glory.
To God be the glory. And literally, it was on and then it's just gone off. Okay. That is an interesting thing. Give me a moment. You know, I prayed at the start that God would, that we would just be led and guided by God. And if He wants to do something different, then He will. And clearly, He doesn't want the piano. Or the bass guitar. Oh, the bass guitar. Is the bass working as well?
No, but he bobbies.
Yes? I'm going to sing. To God be the glory, great things He has done. So mighty the world that He gave us His Son, who gave them His life and atonement for sin. Accept us just as we are. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for your goodness.
Thank you. Yeah. our support. And Lord Jesus, when I think of our name, we are Cornerstone Christian Centre. And we are the cornerstone for this village, for the surrounding areas. And we know that, Lord, because people come to us and say, will you pray? They ask us to pray. They come to us when they've got problems. So we are the next thing that they can come to. We are their cornerstone. Lord, I just pray that they will look to you, all those that need a touch, all those that have asked for prayer, will look to you this morning, that they will soon have their own cornerstone in their lives, their own support in their lives. Lord, I thank you this morning that you are my cornerstone. I thank you, Lord, this morning that whatever's going on in my life and in my family's lives, I can lean on support, the strong support, which is Christ, our cornerstone. I just praise your holy name this morning. I just thank you for your love and your goodness and your mercy that you shower down on us as a church and as individuals, Lord. I pray that you will indeed just go and visit each one that needs a touch from your hand this morning. Lord, I especially pray for, I know everybody nicknames him as Rolly. I especially pray for Rolly this morning, because even though he's had this tumour for a lot of years, it's been dormant, nothing has been happening. And I just pray this morning that it still won't be happening, that there will be something else, Lord, and that lad will go on to do great and mighty things for you, Lord, one day, Lord. You know how we used to always come to the coffee shop and love to be around everybody, always had a word for everybody. Lord, I just pray that you will just be with Sybil, Lord, be her strength, Lord Jesus. Lord, I just pray this morning that you will just visit every person in their seats this morning, that we will each take something afresh from you this morning. I was just watching my bird table this morning, Lord, and there was different birds lined up, awaiting for the others to go so that they could come in and get their portion. Lord, this morning we don't have to wait to get in for our portion. It doesn't matter how many's there waiting. It doesn't matter how many's waiting there to be fed from you. We can all be fed this morning from you, Lord Jesus. I just thank you, Lord. I praise your holy name. Amen.
Here this morning, Father, we give you the praise, we give you the glory for what you have done, what you are doing, Father, and what we know that you are going to do. Oh, hallelujah. Just be praised and lifted up in this place this morning, Father. In Jesus' name I ask it, and for your glory.
Amen.
Mighty Savior.
Amen. One of the lines in that song was, taste and see that the Lord is good. And we do, we taste, we have tasted and we do, Lord, taste and see that the Lord is good. Lord, you are so good to each one of us, Lord, better and bigger and greater, and Lord, even than we can imagine, Lord, your love for us is so deep, so vast, so mighty, and Lord, we are just in awe of you today, in awe of your presence. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord, that you died for us. Thank you, Lord, that you went all the way to the cross. You gave your life so that we can have life. You gave your life so that I can, Lord, know your freedom, know your liberty. Lord, you give me life so that I have a hope. I have a surety that, Lord, I know, Lord, without doubt. Lord, you have a plan and a purpose for my life. And, Lord, you have a plan and a purpose for each of our lives. Lord, as we put our hope and our trust in you, Lord, you take us, you lead us, you guide us in your ways. And Lord, we have an eternal hope. We've sung about it today, Lord. When you return on that day, when the trumpet shall sound, and Lord, you will come back, all eyes, everyone will see, everyone will know, Lord. Lord, I thank you. I thank you for the hope that we have in you. You are our rock, our sure, firm foundation. Lord, that talks about security. Lord, that talks about someone who will never fail. And Lord, you don't fail us. You don't let us down. Thank you. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. We are going to come and remember his death and his resurrection. We're going to come and take the bread and the cup. So prepare a cup. This is the hardest part of the service. Actually getting the cup open. One day we will be able to share the cup like we used to do. We can actually have cups where we don't need to have a degree in engineering to open it. We do thank God for the things that we've been doing in the meantime, but you know, God, there's a better way.
Amen.
Amen. I need to be more serious, don't I? This laughing and this joke. You know, God desires us to enjoy his presence. You know, we can enjoy his presence. We can say, at his right hand there are pleasures forevermore. You know, come into his presence with thanksgiving in your heart. Doesn't say come into his presence with morbid, miserable faces. He desires us to come with joy today. And yes, can we even come around his table with joy? Yes, we can. We come knowing that he's given us the victory, that we are victorious people today. And it's not, in one sense, it's a serious thing that we remember, but actually we come to celebrate communion. We're celebrating his life. We're celebrating his death on the cross. His word says, "For I received from the Lord what I also passed unto you." The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, he took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And Lord, we do. We say, this is your body for us. And Lord, we remember it. Every time we take this, we remember, Lord, what you did for us. Amen. And in the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it, in remembrance of me." Yes, Lord, we thank you for your blood that was shed, for the forgiveness of sins. Lord, you are the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. And Lord, we celebrate this morning. We celebrate your shed blood that cleanses us from all sin. Amen. But whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Amen. the word right now. We pray, Lord, that we would come to you with our ears open, our spiritual ears, our spiritual eyes. Lord, speak to us. Lord, even through this simple story, we pray that you would impart something afresh to us. In the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. And like I said, it is a simple story. It's a story that we've heard many times over the years. It's a story that we tell to children. It's about the baptism of Jesus. The baptism of Jesus, when Jesus was baptized by John the Baptist. And it's only a handful of verses from Matthew chapter 3, 13 to 17. Then Jesus came from Galilee to the Jordan to be baptized by John. But John tried to deter him, saying, "I need to be baptized by you, and you come to me." Jesus replied, "Let it be so now. It is proper for us to do this, to fulfill all righteousness." Then John consented. As soon as Jesus was baptized, he went up out of the water. At that moment, heaven was opened, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and lighting on him. And a voice from heaven said, "This is my Son, whom I love. With him I am well pleased." Or "in whom I am well pleased," however, whichever version you want. This is such a simple story. And I believe as I was reading this, and like I said, it's a story we tell children. It's a what would be classed as a nice story. It's a lovely story, but actually, what is God saying to us? Because it's okay sharing Bible scriptures, but actually, what is God really saying to me or is saying to you today? To begin with, I thought how simple it is that Jesus came from Galilee to the Jordan. He came with the express intent to be baptized by John. He came that day with a focus. Jesus knew he was going to be baptized. He knew he was heading from Galilee to the river. And he knew that John the Baptist would be baptizing people. And Jesus came with the intent to be baptized. Needless to say, John got a shock. John the Baptist got a surprise. John hadn't thought that day, I'm sure when he woke up, "Oh, I'm going to be baptizing the Son of God today." I'm quite certain he has, because he says a couple of times, "Look, I'm not good enough." This wasn't part of John's plan. John sees Jesus coming, and Jesus says, "Yes, baptize me, John, baptize me in the river." "Whoa, no, it should be the other way around. Hang on, I'm not good enough." He even talks about he's not even fit to carry his sandals a few verses before. Not even fit to tie his... "Oh, whoa, Jesus, like, no way. You should be baptizing me." This doesn't fit with John's expectations. This doesn't fit with what John thinks should happen. Because John's got a mindset of, "Well, I'm okay to baptize these people, but oh no, I can't do that because that's not what I do. I can't baptize him." John's world, in a few seconds, is turned upside down. Jesus is the more powerful one. Jesus is the Messiah. Jesus is the promised one. I can't baptize you. You know, we might have been in a situation similar to this where we were expecting one thing to happen, or maybe not even expecting anything at all. And maybe it's when a prayer that we've asked for time and time again, maybe it doesn't seem to be answered. It's maybe when we don't seem to understand what's going on and we don't know why things are happening that way. When it doesn't work out how we think, when the expectations that we had aren't exactly what really happens and what really comes about. That can be hard. And in those situations, John and us have two options. You can either resist and prevent, and whatever's coming our way, and say, "No, well, John could, well, he could have been completely, well, no, no way, no, I'm not baptizing Jesus. No, I'm not doing it. No, I'm not good enough to baptize you. No. And he could have said no. Or we can permit and we can let it be. We can say, yes, God, have your way. Yes, God, I didn't expect that, but actually, yes, do what you want, because you know better. Eventually, in verse 15, we read that Jesus says, it should be done, because we must carry out all that God requires. That's another version. It had to be done. It was, that's why Jesus was going that day to be baptized. It was all part of the plan, part of God's plan. This consent that now John says, it's not about a, oh yeah, okay, then that's fine. It's a deeper thing than that. It's a, John knew in himself, look, this is the Son of God before me. This is the Messiah. This is the one that we've been waiting for. And he says, right, I'm going to be part of this. Well, he might not say that in his head, but I'm paraphrasing what he might think. I want to be part of what Jesus wants. I want to, whatever Jesus wants, let me be part of it, John's saying. And you know that's what I want me to say, I want us to say. We might not understand our expectations, we might not fully know everything and all the bits in between, but what God wants, I want. What Jesus wants for me and this church and this community, that's what we want. Yeah? Yeah. I'm sure we can stand or sit together. Usually you're sitting down standing. We can be together and say, yes, Lord, whatever it is, however we expect it, if it's not what we think, it's what we think. Lord, have your way. Yes. That's really what John was saying. It was like, yeah, I know I shouldn't be because I'm not good enough, but yeah, I'll do what you want because I know that's what you require. And you know, that's all God requires. God requires a willing heart. And we were just saying the other day, what a blessing you are to us. What a blessing you are that there's a willingness, there's an openness to serve. There's a servant heart, quite obvious. And it's amazing when I don't even need to ask people to do a certain thing because people just do it. And that shows a servant heart. That shows a willingness to follow, even if it's washing pots up. And you might think, well, I'm just washing a few cups. No, that's a servant heart. That's what God wants. God wants us to do whatever he's called us to do. It might be operating the camera. It could be playing bass guitar. It could be doing the computer. It could be putting the tables out. But you know, they're the things that God wants. They're the simple little things. It's a servant heart. It's not that, oh, you will do it or you will be beaten with a stick. God doesn't say that. God says, come with an open heart. Come with a servant heart. Come and do those things that I've called you to do. There's those verses in Isaiah 55, which I must say probably every single time I preach, because I love them so much. My thoughts are nothing like your thoughts, says the Lord, and my ways are far beyond anything you could imagine. Let these words that we say so often just sink in again. God says, he reminds us today, my thoughts are nothing like your thoughts. I'm so pleased about that, says the Lord. And my ways are far beyond anything you could imagine. For just as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts, God says, higher than your thoughts. Rather than fighting against what God wants, we're called to submit to what God wants. We're called to be followers, we're called to be servants of the living God. A.W. Tozer, the famous American pastor and speaker and writer, and he writes, God knows us better than we know ourselves. And he does. God knows us better than we know ourselves, and he knows exactly what we need and when we need it. So he knows us better than we know ourselves, and he knows exactly what we need and the right time and when we need it. So that was the first point. The others aren't as long, I promise. Secondly, it said about Jesus coming up out of the water, and at that moment heaven was opened. Heaven was opened, and he saw the Spirit of God coming down, descending like a dove. The Holy Spirit was given, was poured out. Now, Jesus' baptism, we see how All of God's requirements are fully met. And it's almost like, it's like a neon sign saying, point to Jesus, look, this is Jesus, this is the Messiah, this is my son, I'm really pleased with him. But they didn't have neon signs then. So God speaks, and the dove comes down, the dove, symbol of the Holy Spirit, and Jesus, as he's baptized, it's like an announcement on the internet. Right? Messiah's here, Jesus has come, this is who you should follow, this is what you need to be like, he's the example, now Jesus is going to start doing this stuff. Because up to this point, there hadn't been. So this is Jesus, he's here, his ministry's coming, get ready, follow him, listen to him, hear what he's saying. Jesus didn't need, in one sense, he didn't need to come and be baptized, he didn't need to come because he didn't have any sin, he didn't need to sort of have that outward show of sort of being cleansed and being cleaned, but he identifies completely with the people's sin. He identifies completely with us as humans, as people who are sinners, and he comes and he does that to show that affinity with people, with us. So yes, he's God. Yes, he's the Son of God, but also he comes to show us, this is what I want you to do. This is baptism. This is what it is. Model of baptism as a symbol of water, that new life, that new birth, whatever you want to call it. Having our sins washed away. There's a verse in Acts 3:30, I wrote this down. In the past, God overlooked such ignorance, but now he commands all people everywhere to repent. Whoa, that's a bit strong. Is it? Isn't that what the gospel's about? Isn't that what John was saying? Go repent and be baptized. Wasn't he saying, people to repent? Well, if we accept the gift of salvation, if we accept Jesus into our heart, we want to repent. We want to say, look, Lord, we've messed up again. Look, Jesus, I'm really sorry. I've done that again. I've said that again. Please forgive me. Please come and just fill me again. Come and accept of my repentance. So it's what we're expected to. All have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Yes, even pastors. Yes, even pastors who have been far more experienced than I have. Even people who have been in the church all life from their first day. Every one of us has fallen short of the glory of God. There was only Jesus that hadn't. But yet, he showed us the way. He showed us what to do. So let's come in repentance before, and that's what we've remembered, that's what we've done as we've taken communion this morning. We've come before a loving and gracious Father God, and we've come in repentance. And finally, isn't it amazing to see in this couple of verses here how we see the Trinity work? How we see Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. We've got Jesus the Son coming to be baptized, the physical embodiment of God on earth. Here he is, being baptized by John. If he comes out of the water, the Holy Spirit, it must have been I've seen paintings and they don't do it justice. I can't even imagine how amazing it was. That the Holy Spirit comes down from heaven as this dove. And then there's a voice of God. This is my Son, whom I love. With him, I am well pleased. So Jesus here is empowered with the Holy Spirit, with the equipping Spirit of God. He's to accomplish God's plan for mankind, plan for the whole world. Jesus is literally now the anointed one. He's the King of kings. He's the Lord of lords. Just like it would be in a coronation, the oil would be poured upon him. In a physical sense, he would be anointed with oil. Here he is, Jesus, the anointed one of God, the Son of God, come, anointed, filled with the symbol of the Holy Spirit coming down on Jesus, preparing him for the things that are to come. What a lovely, beautiful picture. God the Father expressing his love for his Son, his one and only Son, and Jesus receiving that power from the Holy Spirit. Three in one, and then that's a whole Bible study, even in those three words there. The Trinity, God, Father, God, the Son, God, the Holy Spirit. But there's something else. I was looking into these words that God speaks about son and father, and this is my beloved son. Because in the Middle East, and as I said, I was looking into it, the language that kings and royalty used was, it wasn't just lord and majesty and servant, but it was also father and son. Often kings would be called father, and they would call their loyal servants or their loyal subjects, they would call them son. So it's almost like God saying, yeah, this is my beloved son, but also the king. He's also the King of Kings. He's also the Lord of Lords. Look, this is, it's pointing to Jesus. It's all about him. It's all about Jesus. And I thought how God says that this is my beloved son in whom I'm well pleased. And I thought, well, what's God saying to us in that? But we are called children of God as well. We are called children of God. In 1 John 3, verse 2, he calls us his own. He calls us, we are his children. Yes, not in the same sense that Jesus is, but we're co-heirs. We're co-opted into the kingdom of God with him. We are his children. However down we might be feeling, however despondent sometimes we get, however we feel, I don't match up to the job, I don't feel good enough. And we all have those days. We all have those times, particularly on Monday mornings at 6:30 when the alarm goes off, I'm thinking, here we go, another week. But, you know, being honest, but you know, I'm going to remember what it says in 1 Peter 2 verse 9. You are a chosen people. God's chosen you with God's chosen me. You are a chosen people. You are royal priests. Something special about that. Yeah, we're God's children. We're chosen. Particularly, specifically chosen for such a time as this. You are royal priests, a holy nation, God's very own possession. I love that phrase. God's very own possession. We are his. He is ours. We are his. As a result, you can show others the goodness of God, for he called you out of darkness into his wonderful light. So we're no longer in darkness. We're no longer walking in darkness where we don't know where we're going and we're stumbling around. But now he's called us into his wonderful light. We are as children of God. He's leading us and guiding us into his ways, into his wonderful light. Amen. So this week, let's be determined, those three things I've spoken about, to be determined to run, be determined to grasp hold of what God has, and be ready when he says go. Be ready to say, yes, even though I don't maybe think it, I don't feel it, I'm not good. He says, yes, I want you to, let's go. Let's go with the plan that God has for our lives. Secondly, let's come to him in repentance. If there is anything, let's come in repentance. And we know that we find true forgiveness for all those who truly repent. And we're to remember that we've been filled with his Holy Spirit. We've already been filled. We've already been empowered. We've already been equipped to do those jobs that he's called us to do. And God says, you're my children. You are special. You are mine. You are, as I said there, you are a chosen people. You belong, we belong to him this morning. And where better place could we be? Where better place could we be in his hand? His hand is so big that we can't even imagine how big it is, because we're all in his hand. He loves every one of us. He knows us by name. He knows how many hairs, I've said, on our heads. He knows who we are. He knows what makes us tick. He knows those things that maybe nobody else knows, because God loves and cares for his children. So be encouraged this week. You are his. You are a royal priest. When you're feeling down, when you're feeling miserable, when you're feeling, remember, you are a chosen people. A holy nation. Holy, royal priests. God's very own possession. Amen. We are going to close with a song in a moment. Let's just bow our heads for a few moments. Lord, that, Lord, we are called your children, that you love us with an everlasting love, a love that is greater, a love that is, Lord, all encompassing. Lord, I thank you that you've called us, that you've chosen us, that you've equipped us and empowered us by your Holy Spirit. Lord, I pray for them as you do call us to do those things. Lord, I pray that we would have a willing heart, that we wouldn't resist what you would do with us, Lord, that you would do within us. Lord, that you would, as you call us, we would follow. As you say go, we will go. As you say do, we will do. Lord, help us to have a willing heart. Help us to have our obedient hearts. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for your love. Thank you, Lord, for your forgiveness. Thank you, Lord, that we stand in your forgiveness today. We stand in your love today. Thank you.
thank you for a wonderful week that you're going to give us, Lord. Help us to grow deeper into you, Lord, this week. And help us to take what we've heard today, Lord, and ponder it in our hearts. And help us grow. Because, Lord, we want to see you glorified here in this town, in this village, Lord. Be with us in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. God bless you. Have a good week.